Underhanded, eccentric, audacious libertines, otherwise known as squeals. Wow. Here we are yet again on another Monday night. Don't switch off because we know who you are. We have on our panel this evening. Yeah, both of you. We have on our panel this evening, Kay, I can't believe I'm sleazing up to another celebrity, Sarah. We have Caroline. What colour does Rob Stitch wear in his underwear rage Hamilton?
Well, I just want to know, you know, like, is it red?
Oh no!
Is it blue?
I can't imagine it's red.
Or does he wear underpants at all?
Oh, Toby, I'm one step closer to a Logie Sullivan.
I'd like to thank God first of all.
Oh. And of course, sitting to my right, Kate. Who the fuck are you, Landry? Welcome, Kate. You're a very special celebrity guest. We're excited.
I realise that because you saved me till last.
I know we did.
That's how you
tell. We're that sort of kids, you know.
If I were movie credits, we'd have saved you till last, and it would have said. And special Kate Langbrook as, you know, Fifi or Jerry.
Starring Kate Langbrook as herself. But no, if you were a cake, you'd be the frosting.
If you were a cake, you'd be the frosting.
Yeah, because I always had the frosting last. So, you know, you introduced last. I'll just shut up now.
No, I put my frosting.
David Frost.
I go the frosting last.
Okay.
I do. I save it.
Save the frosting till last, so you pick it all off. God, you reveal so much on TV.
Because I've really been wondering about that.
And I'm wearing...
The first night in ages I get to sleep.
And I just like to say I'm wearing navy blue underpants.
That will probably spawn some sort of new age self-help book. That will be in the bookshops in 2 weeks' time.
Yes.
Men are from Mars, yes. Women leave the frosting till last.
Yeah, it'll be like that.
I thought we were still on Rob Stitch's underwear.
No, oh, I can't help you with that.
No.
But if I could, I would love to.
Thank you.
Yes, but I'm happy to speculate with you.
Do you think he would donate a pair of his underwear to Bent TV so we could auction them off at our fundraiser?
Well, he does have such a huge gay following.
I hope that didn't seem like too crass a plug.
I don't want a pair.
No, but I'm sure there'd be some people that would bid for it, don't you? Mm. I mean, when we auctioned off your underwear, Lindsay, they were up the front, they had their money. We saw the colour of their money before we saw anything else, didn't we, really?
I know. It was
a special thank you to the Smithsonian Institute for your contribution to that. That's terrific.
Catch the bag.
Excuse me, can we have the show back? Because I'd really like to say, you know, have a chat to Kate if we could.
By all means.
You think? No, disregard it. Dear Jack, it is, you wrote this. Give us a little bit of the...
With a girlfriend of mine who said to me, what a good idea to write a book about real people's breakup letters.
Oh, yes.
I know. And so I went, yeah, that's good. She said, do you want to do it? I said, yes, thinking that it would never happen. And it has happened because this is the land of opportunity. And someone at the table has a breakup letter in this book, and it's not me.
And it's not me.
It's speaking of me.
It's like Cluedo, isn't it?
Well, it's not me because I've never had a relationship. So.
It's me.
Hey. Yes.
Have you really got a breakup?
Yeah, I have.
What's the reference number? It could be like the French Lieutenant's Woman where we all looked for the rude page.
Page 28.
384, I think. You know. That's the screw page.
Caroline Hamilton moved to Melbourne in 1995 to run away from Adelaide, a lover and old people.
Why else would anyone
have
ever told us?
That must be why they have so many churches there, isn't
it? Tell us about the old people.
No, what have you got against them?
Yeah.
Oh, they're just everywhere. They are. And the thing is that, you know, where else would you find in one suburb 2 bowling clubs and a croquet club and a magazine called Grey Power? Everything is slower.
That's sounding perilously like St Kilda.
Well, I won't mention the suburb's name, but it is close to the beach.
Oh. Ooh, does it begin with G and end with G?
No.
Oh, that's the only one.
I want to hear about, I want to hear all the messy details.
Oh, about your love letter.
Yeah. Do you feel like you've been eating dinner at a restaurant and Mike Monroe's just busted and said, come with me to the studio? Do you remember this voice?
Well, no, I don't.
Interesting because at the letter, I won't read the letter because, you know.
Just read the punchline.
But what's really interesting is that you said that after you, at the end of this relationship, you came out of a lesbian, as a lesbian, and he became a policeman. So I find very odd.
Yes, well, this is it. Because, I mean, this person was someone who I used to go to protests at Greenpeace with, and I got bitten on the bottom by a police dog, you know, which is like... We met, we fell in love, I got bitten on the butt, all this kind of thing. And so we did this protesting and, you know, all kinds of illegal stuff, which I won't actually mention, together. And now he's a policeman. And it's like, no way, man. It's like, yeah, I came out as a lesbian, but you came out as a policeman. That's even more shocking.
You came out a dyke and he came out a dickhead.
We were friends and then it was just, no, can't do this. Not on my part, but
he gave you
part.
Permission to he print did. This letter in the book,
yes,
so that's pretty liberal of him.
Yes, it was, and that was actually quite a hard process because I went, look, you know, I'm not asking you this. I'm just asking you this because you wrote the most fantastic letters.
Yeah, it's a great love letter. You know, broken love.
It's a love
Are there modern love letters there? Like,
I'm such an old romantic.
Not from the olden days, but I'm reminded, of course, of the fabulous story of Phil Collins breaking up with his wife via fax. Like, are there any email breakups, any e-breakups?
No, but there was Julian Morris, who was on Channel 9 until recently, RIP, IMT.
God rest their variety.
She was telling us, the Flip, who I do the book with, works at Channel 9, and she told her that she got dumped by fax when she was working as a receptionist in a real estate agent's office, and this guy that she was seeing pressed that repeat thing on the fax. So she came in the morning to the whole ream of the fax paper roll, spewed out across the office floor, and she was receptionist, so she had to pick it all up, and every page said, you're dumped.
I have to remember that. I'm going to file that away.
And,
you know, do that. I've got to get a fax machine.
Yeah.
I'm going to get a fax machine.
No, the thing is that you've got to make them get a fax machine.
Yeah, but I'm going
to
have that, you know.
Then you can just go to the post office.
Because you know how with the new telephone things, it's like you can have that... that thing where you choose not to. Yes, yeah. See, I'm going to get that. I'm going to shut up now because next person I might see might, yeah.
Might remember this and use it all against you.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
But see, I love a relationship because then you can have a fantastic messy divorce. Someone about to grieve the messy divorces. You know, like that's my stereo and that's. Oh, go ahead, somebody. She still talks about the tongs that I took from the relationship. You know, my first long-term relationship, and every time I say, you've got those bloody tongs.
And now
she's hanging on to this.
Well, she's hanging on to that, but you're obviously hanging on to the bloody tongs. What's that?
She has a lot of barbecues, all right?
I don't do a lot of cooking. I mean, they're still pristine. They're almost still in their wrapper.
And they're still at your place. And that's the best thing about it.
Do you get attached to stupid little things, though? It's true.
What are you attached to?
Okay, I'm thinking about this wine cork thing that I left behind at my last house that's shaped like a fish, you know, one of those ones. I can't tell you how often I think about that, and I like never drink wine, but I think about it all the time. I'm like,
I wish I had it.
I just thought it was a thing of beauty.
Yes, I gave a partner of mine this ring that it didn't fit me, but it was made out of a half crown, an English half crown. And actually the same person's in that book. That's one thing that I've gone, as much as I really, really love giving it to you, it's like, I want it back now, but I'm never
going to have it. You can't, you've got to let it go.
I've just gone so melancholic all of a sudden.
Whenever I'm breaking up, I always try and do it, I always try and do it very strategically, you know, because you've got to break up after your birthday, but before theirs.
Yes.
You've got to time it just
Never break up with a twin of your own.
Mm. Don't go out with your twin.
But I think Kay is strangely silent here.
Because I think if I say anything about relationships, I'm going to completely blow my cover.
Do you think?
There have been so many. And And I've loved every last one of them. But I am going through my lesbian phase at the moment. So I think that will probably herald in a whole new life.
Yeah, I did.
And a whole drawer full of kitchen accessories.
That wasn't meant to be a joke. Right. That's a sincere comment, if anybody knows my kitchen. The glass house. No, but I only want to say that because, of course, we do have this fundraiser coming up, Lindsay. Is it a good time to mention it first?
It is a good time because you have directed over there, and that's very, very classy television, Kate.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
And very classy. I like that. You've got to do your best with it. Find a camera and go for
and,
it.
And really sell it.
And sell it. Sell it, yes.
Call me. Call me now. Now, of course, it is a fundraiser for Bent TV. This will be our second fundraiser this year. They're very important.
And it just points to the fact that we really do need your dollars.
Well, look, it's not the little money box which we want to kind of show you later on, but we kind of scratched together all the money that we've got and it comes to about 50 cents, so we're very poor. But
hey, I gave you rupiah.
You did, that's, and I'm sure that's worth a fortune. That's worth nothing. It comes from Indonesia.
Nothing. It's not even worth anything in Indonesia.
This is what I'm saying.
That's why they gave it to me.
They're maybe writing. I can take that and fashion it into a ring.
Thursday the 10th of December, that's this coming Thursday, 7:30 at the Glass House is our Christmas fundraiser for Bent TV. So do come along, there are two shows, Lindsay.
Is there?
Wild Rice will be performing, they're a fabulous girl band.
That violinist, isn't she divine? I have to say, she is divine.
She is divine, yes. But I quite like Kaz, who's the lead vocalist, she's very good as well. And we have a performance from the Sherrills, whom some of our viewers will have seen on the...
Excellent.
...will have seen on the... They're great. They're so good.
The Moe Girls.
Oh, yes. They're brilliant.
Come along. Gold coin donations on the entry. Thursday night, it's a good night. Fundraiser for Bent TV at the Glass House.
Yeah, we know we want your dollars and everyone to have a good time, so do that. Now, Kate, the book, it's obviously been released.
Yes.
Well, we hope it has. There has been an embargo date set and gone.
No, it's fully everywhere.
Yeah, and you're selling thousands upon millions of copies.
No, well, I don't know, but we're giving the royalties to Adult and Children's Literacy Fund.
Oh, good.
Foolishly, because...
So that tragically, some people haven't been able to read their breakup letters.
Exactly.
And they've never known.
That's it.
They didn't know what was going on. The next thing, the girlfriend's on the door going, I want my records back. What's going on there?
Breakfast table every day, quite happily. It's just
very
everywhere.
Okay, well, get yourself a copy because it is going to a worthwhile cause. And it has some fantastic crits on the back, even what's this? Bruce Ruxton.
That's one of the letters.
What's this? Oh, Bruce Ruxton.
Bruce Ruxton.
Wow. Can we get into this?
Dear Monty, I know we've come to be very fond in the trenches.
Isn't he the one that said, kiss me quick, Hardy? Was that him as well? Bruce Ruxton?
No. It was
Henny Youngman.
It was a long time ago in another country and besides the wench is dead.
Oh.
Wow.
Okay, we will be back very, very shortly with another 15 minutes or so, or half an hour, whatever it is, of the fabulous squeal with the fabulous Kate. There was toilet paper in the toilet during that last break. We're back and we're being joined by the fabulous Daniel I Want Santo's Job Borton. How
thanks,
are you,
Lindsay.
Daniel?
Good, thanks.
How do you feel having a real star, a real TV star? Look, he's smiling from ear to ear.
It is different.
It
for
is,
us.
Yeah, for us.
Oh, what are you saying? Everywhere.
Oh, babe.
Are you kidding? It's pretty amazing for us to have like a real TV in the studio.
Yeah. A real camera, you know, those shoeboxes.
Anything.
I'd like to thank Fisher Price for their support of those things over the previous weeks, but this is exciting.
Now we're actually going to do some news because that's why we're here.
Sure. Oh,
ho hum. So, Carolyn, what have you got?
Well,
take us away, baby.
Okay. I was reading in one of the gay rags this week that Italian surgeons have they've asked for permission to. Yes.
I just saw it. Did you see that?
I want to.
Sorry. Banana guilty of sodomy.
Wow.
What a great
dang.
Sorry, but that's actually got nothing to do with the.
Tell me, will it appeal?
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, come on.
But the Italian doctors are asking for permission to do the world's first penis transplant. and it's for people who have lost their. Come on, this is serious medical stuff.
I'm not saying a word.
who have lost their penises through accident or through
through no fault of their own.
No, vicious breakups.
By not being married to Lorena Bobbitt, nothing like that. But the thing is that where they're getting the penises from, or is it peni? I don't know.
Where are they getting them from?
Penises is by patients on life support machines. So I was thinking there could be,
speaking in plural, but surely there's not such a huge demand for penises.
Oh, you'd be surprised. There certainly is on this end of the table.
Speak for yourself.
Quite an extra few. Yeah, but yeah, I'm just worried about that, you know, taking it from someone who's still alive. Obviously doesn't need it, but they might need it later when they wake up.
What do you mean? What do you mean? Just because they're in hospital doesn't mean you don't need your penis. I mean, haven't you seen Carry On Matron? It's critical.
They use a catheter and everything, don't they? That's all tubes, isn't it? Tubes and pumps when you get to that stage. You don't really...
An adult can be.
Normal bodily functions don't really count, do they?
So you're afraid someone's going to come out of a coma and go, I'm alive, but I've got no dick, and freak out a bit.
Yeah. Exactly. It'd be a bit of a, you know, what happened in the accident? What happened when that
I was in here for an ingrown toenail. What's going on?
Yeah, came in to have my tonsils out. Too low.
And they're also worried about the ability of the transplanted organ to maintain an erection.
Oh, that's my concern.
Mm.
You know, like all penises that would have to be worried about rejection.
Yes.
That would be a major worry.
Yeah. When your penis rejected.
Yeah, you're being rejected by your own penis. Yeah, that's really the bottom of the barrel.
Exactly. So, yeah, I thought I had to
To ascertain at this point, if I may, the size of the market for used penises.
Oh, the size of the
market, yes.
I cannot, you know, like it's been a long time since somebody come up to me and says, God, I need a new penis.
Yes, I wonder.
Oh, I need
stats
a penis.
On this. This is the point.
Oh, look, yeah, I need a new penis. I've been driving this one for about 75. And it's clapped out, the clutch is gone. Shame. It's, you know, it's terrible on heels.
I thought it was in near new condition. What does that just mean?
Reconditioned.
Not removed from box.
Oh, no. Only owned by a grandmother who only drove it on Sundays.
You need more and more.
Free to good home.
Hey. Yes, that's right.
We'll add all the shots.
Double up as a flagpole on Monday morning assembly.
Smart.
What else?
I hate it when the tone of the show gets that high.
No, we kind of went straight for the crutch.
What else do you have? Well, I was thinking we could do the There's This Guy.
There's a guy.
Everybody's favourite segment, There's This Guy.
There's This Guy, right?
Mm. What about the banana sodomy thing?
The sort of I read
is that
it.
Is a different story or the same story?
Just this guy, right? Whose last name is Banana, and he's been accused. I mean, it's nothing, you know, about a banana.
His last name's Banana.
Yeah, his last name is Banana. I mean, you know, that's sort of.
Does it link
I think
up
we should just let him go with that because that's a bit sad in itself.
Brenda Banana, the Banana family. Sorry,
Smith.
But there's this guy, right, in England, who is. Sorry. He's,
anybody know the etymology of last name? Banana. I'm just trying to work out what they did in that family to be named Banana.
They would feed the monkeys.
Zookeepers. Yes,
of course.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Those zookeepers.
Your turn now.
I apologise. Right. You've got another story there. You're jumping
in. There's this guy, right? In England, who is addicted to Christmas.
He's totally addicted to Christmas.
Yeah, and he's it's the reason why it's so detrimental to him is because like he started off at 79 kilos, you know, which is pretty good weight for a guy, whereas now he's 100 and something kilos because he eats so many mince pies and
turkey.
And turkey.
I was going to say, do you think to get off his addiction, you go cold turkey and ham with turkey?
Oh, yeah. 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 Exactly.
I want to know if he snorts Christmas, takes it intravenously, or smokes it.
No. He's just addicted to all the food and everything.
Have you finished?
And I actually find this disturbing because.
Please.
He says, Brussels sprouts are my favourite. I could eat bowls and bowls of them at a time.
What a freak.
I don't find that Christmassy. That's not Christmassy.
It's like, when did Brussels sprouts come into Christmas?
Yeah.
And
we have them.
Who the hell would want to eat bowls and bowls of them? This guy doesn't need to lose weight.
I reckon this Christmas thing's
therapy.
This Christmas thing's a smokescreen. It's just a poor attempt to cover up a Brussels sprouts. thing.
Addiction.
Yeah.
The thing is, we know if you eat that many Brussels sprouts, that they're like a cabbage. They go straight through, don't they? So he's actually telling a couple of pork pies about the weight thing, I think.
Yes, because it's a lot of the things that you're putting on the Brussels sprout.
You just wanted to get in the paper. It's a filler. What paper is it from? The Age. It's a filler.
I was just going to say, Carolyn, I heard recently that in Australia we do have a very serious problem with that time of year because we don't just have like the traditional Christmas lunch. We have, as well as the traditional Christmas lunch turkey, we have like the barbecue. So we like do two Christmases.
See, this year, my two housemates and I are doing the sushi
don't
thing.
You?
We're just going.
Yeah, sushi. A very sushi,
sushi for Christmas.
Oh. Yeah,
because she is Japanese, you know. Look at her.
No, I just love sushi, and it's one of my favourite foods.
For Christmas, though,
yeah,
you want to have starch.
Oh, stuff.
Do you have the Christmas pudding?
Turkey. That wasn't even meant as a joke, but you know, I can't be bothered doing all that hot cooking, you know.
How are you going to hide a penny in the sushi?
Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Oh, I just got it.
The Christmas pudding.
No, there's just no. We're just going to stick a whole heap of pennies on the table and everyone can.
I've just got one more shocking pun.
Okay, cool.
Because apparently being addicted to Christmas is quite bad for your elf.
Look at my face.
Okay.
I should have
just remember this. Remember this expression on my face and pun no more.
I should have stayed with the box.
I've flicked through this during the break. Don't you just love that? During the break, like we really, you know, we work during the break. The letter from Bruce Ruxton.
Yes.
Now, Bruce obviously doesn't know that the Australia on Collins was a gay bar from about 1918, and that's all he talks about. But I looked around one day and saw all those Yanks in their sissy uniforms, and I said to one of my mates that it was no wonder the Sheilas went for us. We may have looked a bit rough, but there was no doubt what we were there for, and there was even less doubt about the girls, what the girls wanted. I was only too happy to oblige. It was probably like all the drag queens that like a bit of rough trade. Bruce! Honestly. Which brings me to another point, Jack, and I don't quite know how to break this one to you. No, he's not gay. One night I was in the Hotel Australia and your Millie came in. Blimey, she looked lovely. Great figure, perky little hat.
Look,
every inch a lady. And for 19, she certainly had style.
Millie Minogue.
And he said you could use this.
Yeah.
Isn't he a marvellous human being? I love him.
Perhaps he does.
He's the only person in the world that does.
Well, he probably does. Well, that's it. He's probably hanging out with drag queens and what have you.
Well, there you go.
Have you read MSO and you're going to contribute something from MSO?
Oh, I'd love to.
Is that what you're playing with it?
Well, yes. MSO, of course, this week, we should be giving them a bit of a plug.
We're
going to be quoting them. They have the fantastic graphic of Vanessa Wagner on the cover. You probably have to get that. But as well as this on the cover, there are a couple of letters. Oh. It's like an agony aunt. Agony aunt thing. What do you say? I don't know. But it's kind of like
agony
aunt.
I
can't but notice in MSO
problems.
This week there are a number of confessional letters from people at the VAC, and I can't really go into very much detail because I'll get in a lot of trouble. But for my bet, Susan Harbin's letter wins the prize because it's like War and Peace; it goes on forever. And you've got to ask yourself, who was it that actually paid for the
envelope?
It's a whole page, but Susan had a lot to say. Because they're doing the musical CEO and resident thing down at the VAC again. They do this every 6 or 7 months.
Would that have to be would that be a paid advertisement?
Well, I wonder. Yeah, perhaps it's a community grant.
Yeah, for a full paid advertisement. It is. Dan, you'd be really quiet.
It's pretty riveting.
I think it's because you're here.
Do you reckon?
Yeah, you found.
You were cruising up to me before, but I saw this show a couple of weeks ago. And you had Val Lehman on. So I know that I'm just like nothing to you. So don't be pretending to be impressed.
You haven't even had one tedious showbiz anecdote from the 60s
so far.
Oh, do you
want one?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you got one?
Oh, no. Tell us what. That's like those. Are you dissing? Are you dissing B?
Oh, I've never disagreed. I know which side my bread's buttered on. I've got no desire to end up face down on the ironing board.
Yeah, that's exactly
I'm not
right.
Disagreeing.
Actually, we haven't even asked anything about the panel, have we? All the dirt and the goss and what's happened.
We asked about the underwear.
Yeah, we asked. But what else? You've got any dirt and goss?
Well, no.
Because no one watches this.
Well, you need to ask me specific things.
No one watches this, particularly casting directors working on the panel, it would seem.
Let me see. Rob Sitch's underwear, we've been through that.
There might be nothing to
ask. What's she really like?
God, she is
difficult to work with.
Oh, she's just, you know, the mystery of it is why she was allowed on television.
Drinks like a fish.
Oh, the drinks like a fish. Yeah,
does
yeah,
everybody
yeah,
write yeah, get down to my notes here that somebody wrote? Initially didn't want to do it. Squiggle, camera shy,
yes,
was approached by Rob Sitch, It All At said no.
Yes.
So you said, It All At said no.
So, yes, et al.
Et al.
I said, I don't understand your Latin, sir. No, yeah, they because I do Triple R Breakfast Show here and a couple of them listen to it and they
so
sort of approach me.
Broadcasting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It's like this, except mercifully without the vision.
Pictures, yeah.
And that, so they asked me about doing this show that they were talking about doing and I was just sort of really reluctant because, you know, the camera thing is really odd and I do believe that it steals your soul and I believe that because I've seen Carrie Ann Hadaway.
We never
had
one, Kate.
Yeah, no, that's
well,
it.
Lindsay, you realise
that
makes
soul.
Us soulless yeah, completely.
So that's no, right. I was just really reticent about it and they just kept saying, you can talk about whatever you want and it's just going to be like Breakfast Radio and I was thinking, as if. And then lo and behold, it is.
Yeah.
It is,
yeah.
So,
it's a nice
you know,
tone.
Mm. Yeah.
It's yeah, a good so show. It's just sort of, it seems eerily similar to this somehow.
And how do you feel about the success of the program, though? Because it was kind of like, excuse me.
We're having a moment.
You
wouldn't understand this.
No puns. No, but it's kind of like, it's heralded as kind of, you know, breaking new ground in television. All of a sudden, there's huge ratings. The panel.
Because
you must be daunted by that.
Is so simple? Well, it's not really my show, so I don't
know. No, but you're part of it.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's just, it's that talking thing. It's truly just people talking. And nice. So obviously, yeah. And I suppose early on people were going, why would people turn on to watch five or six people just talking in their lounge rooms? But people like conversation. And I suppose there's always that thing that you feel like you're a part of it or something, except yeah, for poor old Toby.
It's like the,
I've done my dash now.
It's kind of like the yeah, missing link for television, isn't it? Because television really kills conversation normally.
There we go. Well, look at that. The dribbling sands.
Oh! He's alive!
Well, as we know, Christmas is coming up, and we've decided to do a little bit of a focus on the tackiest items around this year. This is just the most amazing Santa. As you can see, he blows bubbles. Yahoo! Have a look at him. There he goes. Can you see that? There we go. But have a look at this. She is just superb.
This is. Do you want to do it, Lindsay?
Oh, no. It's been a while, Kay. I wouldn't mind.
Hey!
Hang on. You have to get a close-up. I don't want to run out of spring. Look how the leg comes out. The leg comes out to get the coin into the money box. It's called a beautiful beauty in a bath.
Look at that.
But she's also got a bit of that, you know.
Yes, her hand massages her right chest. I think that's wonderful.
Very isn't she? Yeah, I used to have a girlfriend like that.
Oh. I just want to point out this is like a. Sorry.
She's so stuck.
Oh.
Her aim's pretty good.
She's not bad.
I think she's wonderful. I'm in love
with the
plastic woman. But isn't this? I mean, this is just. Just listen to this.
I think we're really showing our true colours on this show. That's gorgeous.
Isn't that beautiful?
That's so pretty. I feel like I'm going to cry.
Daniel, what do you think of that? Because you're from Mount Waverley. Mount Waverley's right with this sort of shit.
Every time I'm on, I get bagged and.
Because you were.
The day the music
got there. Soap studs in the battery compartment.
He has. So, Mount Waverley, do you want to tell us what's happening out there? Because it's so funny.
Very little, I imagine. Not much, as usual.
No? So you'd
have all the big suburban shopping centre Christmas decorations and you know, Santa Elvis in Centre Court and all those.
Oh, okay. Santa Elvis.
There's a shortage of Santas this year.
Yeah.
Is there?
So I heard.
Really?
I saw a tram of Santas the other day.
Oh, tram.
Because you know what Santa's like? When I was little, you used to go up to Myer's rooftop, right? And they'd sit you on Santa's knee and he always stunk like whiskey. And he'd be jumping you up and down. I'm sure they were all, you know, nasty old men. And this horrible whiskey breath and this jumping up and down. And, you know, every year my grandma would say, why don't you want to see Santa? Because he stinks. he stinks.
And he always asked me for a dollar to get the tram of presents. I hate him, Mum.
Yeah, he's always he's horrible. What do you have for us anyway, Daniel? We'll lift up the
You've
the
done
show.
So much work during the week. You've got articles galore.
Yes, school suit over sunburn. You heard it first, folks. Is this in the Mount Waverley Gazette, by the way?
No.
Oh, good. Okay.
That of the Herald Sun.
Oh. Okay. Oh,
so it must be true.
Yeah. Mario West Primary School. A 7-year-old girl went on an excursion and got sunburned. Now her parents are suing the school, claiming that it's their fault. They claim that the school teachers should have supervised and made sure that everyone was wearing a sunburn.
Why are you looking at the monitor, Daniel?
Yeah, there's a camera there.
Oh, is it? I beg your pardon. I don't want to ruin your technique.
They're claiming that...
I'm off his Christmas card list.
Oh, I think so.
Go on, darling.
But the school principals are saying that they can't put, that teachers cannot put suntan cream on the students because they can get accused of sexual harassment.
What sort of shock was, can we go back? What sort of shock was that?
Can they put it on themselves?
What were they doing?
Did you see this? This is art. This is pure art. Andy Warhol, eat your heart out. Now this is what.
Going back to it?
Go back.
Go back.
In case you missed it.
Oh, that's good.
Just look at that. What was it?
It was a show of the
I think it's so.
No, you can't. You've got to sink them in.
You can't do that. You can't do that. So she's suing
quick,
the school.
Quick, they're not being very interesting. Freak them out with one of those TV and TV shows.
Now, the thing that amazed me was that the news of the poor sunburnt child, you let out an explosion of saliva to rival Santa.
Well, it's a guy thing.
Without even the sunlight.
I can tell you, but then I'd have to kill you.
Yeah. We just give Toby a dollar and say, can you do that spit thing again?
I also do the bath thing, but that takes more than a dollar.
Do you know I would love to stay in Chattanooga, but I have to go to my gig.
What do you mean?
Down at the Glass House. It's the venue where our fundraiser is at. Thursday the 10th.
Oh, the fundraiser. Yeah.
Do you want to keep my chair warm, Daniel?
I'm fine here.
All right. So there'll be a gap between you and Carolyn.
I'll move.
That could work.
Golly, this is spontaneous too.
I'm taking my beautiful...
This is anarchy.
Oh, here's more money from Ben TV.
Oh, thank you.
There we go.
Who the hell are you anyway?
Get out of the chair,
Adeline.
If Kay's going, I'm going.
It's turning
get out of here.
Oh, no, I've had one pun too many. Where's the microphone?
Just get out.
Who the fuck are you busting in our show?
You'll never know.
On your way, sister.
From now on, I'm listening to Tracy and Matt in the morning.
Yeah, me too.
And I don't get up in the morning anyway.
Go on.
Go.
Oh, white trash. Well.
I reckon she was just trying to emulate last week's, you know.
Yeah, she's ripping the stuff off.
Yet again.
Yeah.
They'll never work in this town again. Well, now what do we talk about that everybody else has gone? Well, hi, folks. This is Little Squeal.
This is why we need the fundraiser. We're running out of people.
We're running out of people.
We're having to sell our panellists.
We just gave our money to some plastic chick in a bathtub. What are we talking about?
We can't even dangle carrots. It's a parsnip or a turnip, and that's it, you know? And they come.
We can say fuck now.
Oh, fucking all right.
Stop it.
Yes, it's official. The F word is now acceptable language on Australian commercial television after 9:30. Well, we're not commercial television. But it's now acceptable language after 9:30.
That's great.
We still can't say, but we can say.
So 7-year-olds around the land, before they go to bed at, you know, 10 o'clock, they run around saying the F words. Like, well, I can say it now, Mum, because it's after 9:30.
They allow it on telly, so we can do anything. Yeah. Telly is God.
Looking forward to some innovations in programming. Then I'm looking forward to, you know, watching shows like, yeah, Pacific Fucking Drive and Sale of the Fucking Century. That sort of stuff.
Yeah. Yes. Is it necessary? Because, I mean, do we have to reclaim everything? Like, you know, gays, we've demystified or whatever the words queer and faggot and all that.
It's part of everyday language, really.
Yeah, you hear it on the tram more often than you hear it.
It's not something you say, you know, please say the F word, but it's something that, you know, everyone uses all the time. It slips out of my conversation all the time, and I have to consciously think not to say the F-word.
Well, that's right. I mean, when we were looking for talent for this show, Caroline, that did come into being, that the F-word did pass her lips far too often, along with many other words like, I used to love you, but now your feet are too big and I'm away. Caroline's available, by the way, everybody out there.
Just ring up Bent TV.
9663 5902. Now, Caroline, now I want you to go on with a vampire on a murder charge.
This is just like, you know, I was talking about the cocaine thing before,
you know, the Santa thing and all that kind of stuff. I just thought, oh, look, I love the Herald Sun and I love the Age. And they just come up with the most amazing stuff. There's, in San Francisco, there's this guy, right, who claims to be a 2,000-year-old vampire. And look, I'll tell you, he must have had so many facelifts because he just doesn't look a day over 30.
Look a day over 700.
He's just a bit of a mentally unwell person, I think. And he's sated his appetite by sucking his victim's blood. But everyone who's been asked, you know, who's survived attacks by this guy has said, no one's ever tried to suck my blood. So, I don't understand it. And they've got a picture of this guy, which is actually really small. And I don't know, camera two, can you get it? Oh, maybe I won't show the name. I'll just show why. We can't show this man's name on telly.
Because he's a vampire.
There we go.
So remember that he's been going around saying, I tried to kill this person, I tried to kill that person. They ask the people and they go, no.
Yeah, no. They say, well, you know, he attacked me, but, like, never tried to suck my blood.
Because there were those two lesbian vampires that were on a murder charge. So remember then? That was bizarre. I mean, that really gave us a bad name too, thanks, Sheila's.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah. No, you're from Adelaide, they're from Queensland. Oh, are you?
Yeah. How it all comes out, I just had to throw that in. but the other bit in this wonderful little bit of paper is a quote from Carol Thatcher to President Bill Clinton's daughter, Chelsea, who recently split with her boyfriend.
Ooh.
Oh, sorry.
You heard it first.
If the source of your pain is being daddy's girl, then be more like mum. If she can contend with Monica Lewinsky and turn it to her advantage, you can too. So, yes.
What sort of advice is that for any growing, healthy, heterosexual lass out in the suburbs?
I know, it's like, I think it's
she might as well say, save any dress that's blue and smoke cigars with the president.
No, I think she's saying that, you know, mum, you know, Hillary Clinton's cope with it really well, and that, you know. But anyway, that's my bit of news there.
Well, there you go.
Well, ho.
No one has anything on Hillary Clinton this week, which really disturbs me because I never saw her once. I was really upset. But I did see a lot of Boris Yeltsin, and nobody's brought in the Boris Yeltsin thing because I saw he was on TV and the doctor said, no, you can't meet with, you know, the president of Indonesia and Swahili land and all sorts of things. But he did it anyway. But there was this sort of like plastic man sitting there going, like he can't dance anymore, the poor guy.
Oh,
says,
no.
And he's running the country. And then they showed you Boris Yeltsin back in time. And there was this handsome Russian man, you know, who hadn't hit the vodka at that stage.
But was it like a syrupy montage? And there was like Celine Dion singing and Boris running along the beach. Boris running through autumn leaves.
And who's the one with that funny thing on his head, isn't he?
Is he still alive or did he die?
Yeah, no, he's still alive and doing, you know, signings and whatever and stuff like that. But you know, on Russian TV they used to Photoshop out his little thing.
Really?
So to this day there's no Russian that knows that their leader had a weird ass head.
Yeah, because that was weird, wasn't it? That was weird. Anything else for us?
No, there's a new park.
God, where's your bloody news anyway?
Do you want this one? There's a new park going in near the city.
Oh, yes, there is.
Is that in Mount Waverley?
No, the city.
Oh, bang.
The city. And I'm disappointed because there's not even one whizzy dizzy and not even a single pair of monkey
nothing.
Bars going
lots
in
of
there.
There's lots of grass there, which is just plain green grass. And there's nothing else.
That's
except
no
crappy arty things.
What do you mean crappy arty things? Melbourne is built on art.
They're called
sculptures.
Yeah.
Sculptures.
Still crappy.
He's from Mount Waverley. He's from Mount Waverley.
You mean it's a structure and you can't walk into it and buy stuff?
Well, isn't it funny? Like, the star's gone. There's only, what, three of us? I'm ready to go home myself. It's Monday night in Melbourne and I'm going out for a fabulous time. Yeah. Stay watching Bent TV this Monday evening for Big Fat Arts Girl Talk and Hell Bent, which is a sort of a gay variety show, isn't it? Which is really bloody good to watch.
Yeah.
Make sure that you go to the Glass House on Thursday evening from about 7:30 for the Bent TV Christmas break-up sort of fundraiser type party. Well, you'll see us all there. You'll be there, won't you?
Because we need money for script
writers. We need money. Stay tuned. There's another hour or so to go.
We need money for scripts
we'll
for the paper.
Next week.